Welcome everyone here to the Mani event on comparative militarization and narratives of healing. I want to thank the Dean of Arts and Sciences and the Roosevelt House for helping sponsor this event. I also want to thank Professors Peter Kwong, Professor John Chin for helping to organize this, as well as Anthony Wong and Kevin Park, who's not here, who helped support this event. So, each of these members here, Iris Morales, Ayo Shanti, Jose Angel Figueroa, I want to thank each of them for being models for myself in terms of courage and inspiration and passing it forward. I met Ayo and Iris in my class. They were my former students, which is interesting. Here I was teaching a class on ethnic literatures and social movements, and I had a former member of the Young Lords Party who was actively involved in the movements of the 60s and different types of organizing in New York City. And she never told me this information until after. Ayo, I had met in my second year at Hunter College. Here I was a young assistant professor trying to teach curriculum, and I had this person who was kind of different student demographic, who just said something, just spoke certain types of conversations of truth in the classroom. We're working on multi-ethnic literatures. Some of you are taking a course with me. And we're talking about race and the city. And she just raised her hand and said, you know what? Sometimes white folks just walk around like they own everything. And I just was a little dismayed, but kind of taken to that type of honesty. When I first met Jose Angel Figueroa, which was interesting, at a lunch, we were talking about pedagogy and teaching, and he teaches at Boricua College, and he said the first thing that he asked students in the class is, why were you born? Mm-hmm. And that struck me in terms of a conversation as a teacher, because I was on a different type of curriculum pattern, and so I really learned something about the role of educators and what we can kind of impart in the classroom. So today we are going to bridge the university and community. We're going to think about theory and praxis and how it plays out in terms of lived experience. I want to think about the role of the intellectual, activist, and healing life as it converges here at Roosevelt House. This idea of convergence is interesting to me. What does it mean to come together, to be beside someone, to be in a collective space? Today we're going to think about scholarly work. We're going to think about poetic imagination. We're going to think about the power of the human through storytellers, something as a literature professor I'm very much interested in. I want to reimagine the conversations we have in a space like this at the Roosevelt House, and add some soul food, if you will, to the conversation. A question I pose in all my classes: what makes us human in the global age? What types of visions, styles of thought, social relations, epistemological and ontological knowledges can be understood through the understanding of our collective entanglements? So here's a quickening today, a coming together on a fine Friday afternoon. A way to think about this panel is an understanding of our connectivity and the structured violences, especially militarized styles of thought, which condition, shape, ritualize, manufacture consent upon our bodies and communities. I'm thinking about this in terms of psychological, physical, emotional, and spiritual types of dimensions on a cellular level. For my part, I'm going to be reading a brief excerpt from my book, East Meets Black. And I want to think about Afro-Asian critique of militarization through comparative race. Iris Morales, obviously, she's going to read from her new book about Young Lord historiography and state violence. Ayo Shanti is going to, read a selection from her book and think about the policing of our consciousness through structured fear and self-hate versus self-love. And Jose Angel Figueroa is going to bring in New Rican poetics and imagination And we're going to have that conversation. So all discuss and relate revolutionary, evolutionary points of view, whether through social movements, cultural work, or radical restructuring of self-ego through empathy and compassion, all to inspire others. We are not alone, we are connected, and we are here. So I wanted to think about the way in which racial ideologies and racialized projects of comparison shape different communities in terms of how they relate to one another, but also how individual humans relate to one another. Here's a quote from Yuri Kochiyama in Shades of Power, the newsletter of the Institute for Multiracial Justice. Much of the history of African, Asian, and Black American, Asian American interactions is not well known, as it should be. All peoples of whatever race or color have crisscrossed into each other's lives more than we think. In the post-civil rights America, the making of race and masculinity has been a moralizing project. During this era of economic and racial realignment, Asian and Black men have been represented by white supremacy as oppositional humans in U.S. national culture. Inasmuch as Black masculinity summons biological stereotypes of athletic supremacy and bankrupt intelligence, Asian masculinity invokes cultural myths of scholastic dominance and emasculated bodies. Whereas Asian American men are viewed as obedient and meek, Black men are seen as subversive, violent, and threatening. In popular perception and private conversation, Asian masculinity is illegitimate vis-a-vis U.S. national manhood, while Black masculinity represents a total antithesis and repudiation of it. Asian men supposedly perform Isaac Asimov's law of robotics, performing an inanimate interior with a yellow peril work ethic, while Black men harbor the dark continent of Africa with its imagined stain of self-imposed poverty and unruly corruption. Since the mid-1960s, Asian American men have been labeled as model minorities, politely assimilating buffers between white supremacy and Black revolution, while Black men have been identified as public enemy number one, requiring the discipline of law and order. Under this rubric of racial cannibalism, Black and Asian masculinity negate each other, polarized within a binary spectrum of positive and negative moral attribution necessary for the management of a class and racial crisis in the post-civil rights era. So there's a beginning paragraph is thinking about the relational ways in which there's a symmetry of how Asian and African American men are positioned in terms of post-civil rights race logic. In the racial architecture of post-civil rights America, Asian and Black men are positioned along a binary axis that define a system of social meanings and symmetrical contrast to each other. Brain body, hardworking, lazy, nerd criminal, culture genetics, acceptability, monstrosity, submissive, aggressive, self-reliant, government dependent, student, convict, feminization, hypermasculinization, technocrat, athlete, solution and problem, which I term racial magnetism. In this sense, the structural design of racial magnetism is a captivating field formed by institutions that control the means of representation through moral prescriptions of attraction and repulsion. Opposites do attract, don't they? Fundamentally, race is a social construct. It operates in the United States as a regulatory concept to organize a pyramidal structure of wealth, property, status, and life opportunities in a complex negotiation with gender, class, sexuality, and nation that sustains a social order founded upon common sense notions of visual and biological difference. I employ the noun magnetism to stress an ideological field of signification, a magnetic state that reduces the infinite diversity of humanity expressed by Asian and Black masculinities into a simple dichotomy of rivalry and competition. This reification through division prescribes a host of political and cultural meanings onto the body of Asian and Black masculinity. For example, at elite universities and in popular sports, the disproportional representation between Asian and Black men visually reinforces racial magnetism's biological precepts of Black men as all bodies and no brains, and Asian men as all brains and no bodies. Now, just to move forward to thinking about comparative militarizations, Now, in the hospital emergency rooms, the golden hour is the critical time period for resuscitation and survival after a severe trauma such as a heart attack or a stroke. It is a crucial moment when the risk of systemic failure, death in no uncertain terms, threatens to become irrevocable. The viability of market democracy became uncertain when a perfect storm of discontent collectively confronted the centers of decision-making power in the United States. Never before and never since has the United States experienced such multiple and varied assaults from a wide array of social participants and collective political mobilizations, both from within and from afar. The country secured its multi-ethnic future by eliminating immigration quotas from Asia and Latin America, and Fordist and Keynesian modes of production were discarded in favor of growing neoliberal orientations. The post-civil rights era subsequently became an important moment of national reconstruction, similar to the radical reconstruction that took place in the postbellum South 100 years earlier. The time marker post marks an end to the civil rights movement, culminating in the passage of federal legislation, but it also indicates a new tug of war between reformist and radical approaches to reshaping the social contract. Consider a timeline of the golden hour of 1965. President Lyndon Johnson's Great Society speech in January, the assassination of Malcolm X in February, in March, Operation Jackhammer in Vietnam, the first official deployment of US ground troops, the publication of the Moynihan Report, the occupation of the Dominican Republic in April to depose President Juan Bosch, in August, the passage of the Voting Rights Act and the urban revolt in Watts, Los Angeles. And ending the year, the passage of the Hart-Celler Act, which inaugurated America's multi-ethnic future with Asian and Latino immigration. All hallmarked the year, watershed year of 1965, a decisive calendar year shaping imperial, racial, and revolutionary transformations within and against the tenets of market democracy and racial domination. Much has been written about the new left year of 1968, but resetting the racial dynamism of 1960s back to 65 pinpoints a specific and invented trajectory of crisis management that responded to making of history from below. The restoration of class power intersected with comparative racialization, leading to significant consequences. The rise of militant black masculinity would be contained through, quote, mass-based punishment and liquidation, unquote, what Ruth Gilmore calls post-Keynesian militarism. A quickening was seemingly on the horizon of American ruling class hegemony, causing a recalibration of America's political equilibrium and rejuvenating narratives to legitimize its renewal. In such a temporal conjunction and dialectical encounters, the biopolitics of discursive power in institutions and culture played a pivotal role in shaping class warfare and racialized consent. This aggressive form of comparative racialization signaled a new era of subtle, hidden, seemingly more progressive discursive formations about race. Here, I'm theorizing about the scale, scope, and character of comparative racialization between Asians and blacks in the mid-1960s that established the narratives for neoliberal and colorblind justifications. Catherine Lutz argues that militarization is, quote, simultaneously a discursive process involving a shift in general societal beliefs and values in ways to legitimate the use of force. Chandan Reddy suggests that market democracy is a social contract for the authorization of state violence through idealized notions of freedom. Additionally, Tony Negri has aptly connected the rise of the warfare state to neoliberal nation states with the increased domestic militarization of urban space. In this sense, I expand the definition of militarization to include not only military action abroad, but also the aggression of class and racial formation projects that utilize comparative racialization as a primary style of thought for a new multi-ethnic era. In this way, the militarization of comparative racialization during the Golden Hour defines the post-civil rights era of class and racial warfare in two ways. First, the movement towards neoliberal austerity thrust upon the working class and poor, which has resulted in an unprecedented gap between rich and poor. And second, the narrative production of numbness, boredom, and fatigue as affective weapons to promote cultures of cynicism, apathy, and hopelessness that render invisible those human beings suffering from political abandonment. While the United States was internally experiencing racial and class-based conflict in the country's urban centers, Its defeat externally at the hands of an impoverished third world, Vietnam, placed powerful stressors on the viability of market democracy as a global hegemon. Addressing the link between domestic and international forms of militarization and containment, Los Angeles Police Chief Wayne Parker stated about Watts, quote, "The situation is very much like fighting the Viet Cong," unquote, intimating that South Los Angeles was under paramilitary siege. The Watts riots and U.S. aggression in Southeast Asia illustrated an Afro-Asian point of crisis that organized societal beliefs for the production of militarization in various manifestations. Gerald Horn argues that the summer of Watts had been a blackmail revolt against the white power structure, which utilized paramilitary tactics, the National Guard, and Bell helicopters, a high-tech militarization that had been transferred from Asian battlefields to U.S. urban zones. Ultimately, a blackmail revolt against urban poverty, police brutality, and cultural dehumanization had been achieved for the first time in U.S. history. The militancy of black men incorporated guerrilla tactics, displayed concise organizational skills, and mobilized the collective will of subjugated citizens, which would later energize other social movements. Subsequently, the thesis of the Moynihan Report gained traction in popular journalism and became the lingua franca of the neoconservative counter-revolution. The Los Angeles Times declared in a one-page headline, quote, "Racial unrest laid to Negro family failure," unquote. In this period, during which there had been more than 150 racial conflagrations, popular journalism ascribed the cause of black power mobilization squarely on the failures of the black family union. Even though reports by the McCone and Kerner Commission lay responsibility exclusively on systemic abandonment, we can now understand how such powerful expressions of masculine anti-systemic sentiment in organized resistance might need some form of domestic containment. And for me, a way to kind of telescope to this present moment is to think about what David Simon thinks about with Baltimore as a space. The war on drugs, Freddie Gray, certain forms of racial covenants, the ways in which the legal system maps onto the war on drugs and certain types of surveillance. David Simon argues that it's an occupying force that we're seeing in Baltimore. And a certain type of technology or tool of using the war on drugs that pinpoints black and brown communities as a means of social control and as a means of regulating certain conditions of poverty and inequality. So that's one of the ways in which I'm thinking about how comparative race links to a certain type of ideological logic and framework, and how certain types of psychologies, minds, and bodies become ritualized, conditioned, shaped to view the other, right? And how to have a certain type of vocabulary of the other when thinking about different forms of militarization. I want to pass the mic. We're going to move to a selection of poetry, which I think is a different type of vocabulary than my own. It's a kind of poetic way of thinking about some of these topics.
Okay. How are you? ¿Cómo están todos? How are you doing? First of all, thank you and all parties concerned for inviting me here. I've always had problems with a lot of scholars who don't know what to do with poets. And in our political spectrum, we have a lot of people who do a lot of economic analysis, political analysis, and they lecture. And I always say, you know, where do you think the poets fit in this matrix? Because in Latin America, poets are revered, like priests, like sages, people of wisdom and spirituality, not bohemian poets who love pop, who love weed, who are very flighty and get into their cyberspace even before it's become medical or legal. So the poet was born in the classroom And I want to make this brief and let the poetry speak for itself, because any poet that tries to explain his or her poetry will certainly get paralyzed by the analysis. When I was in the fifth grade and came at more or less the years of 9 or 10 years old, and I fell in love with my teacher, her name was Ms. Schaefer, and by coincidence at that time, Puerto Ricans loved Schaefer beer. This is before Budweiser. You know, so I'm talking about the late 50s and 61. And when I went into a classroom, I didn't understand the word homework. So I asked the closest person, ¿qué quiere decir homework? And the teacher heard me, and she came right to me, and she held my hand, and with her long fingernails, she scratched me and said, do not speak Spanish in class. Spanish is bad for you. This is the teacher I fell in love with because she was the tallest person I'd ever seen. Puerto Ricans at that time were like less than 5 feet. So when I saw this giant woman, I said, oh my God, where did she come from? But she tortured me when she heard my Spanish. By the time I knew it, the assistant principal, that was sort of that stereotypical, you know, short marine cut, you know, in your face kind of guy, came in, grabbed me by my shirt, dragged me to his office, rolled up a newspaper, and the minute I sat down, hit me on the head. That was the second assault on me for speaking Spanish. Then they got my mother, who was about half a block away, and she came running, thinking something had happened to me or that I burned the school down. Because the moment she walked in, they were on top of her, no speak Spanish here, no speak Spanish. And she didn't understand why they were talking to her in that way, and she sat down, and the moment that I tried to explain to her why I was in the principal's office, my mother slapped my face because they were so angry at me that my mother thought I really did something the devil could probably applaud. Later when I got home, I explained to her in Spanish, mira amor, mamá, tú siempre me has enseñado a mí ser orgulloso de ser un boricua. You have always taught me to be very proud to be a Puerto Rican. And Boricua comes from Borinquen, the original name of the Taino Indians that go back as 200 BC. Long story shorter, when I explained that I didn't know homework and I spoke Spanish, this is, so she apologized. The next day, without my knowledge, my mother interrupts the class with this teacher, same teacher's writing on the blackboard, homework. My mother rushes in and she's like pins her to the wall and she says, you said I'm on beach. You said I'm on beach. You no touching my son. You no touching my son. You no touching my son. And she like, this is like, you know. And all the kids said, whoa, they were like, and that's where she gave me back my pride. And that's where the poet and the rebel imagination, to quote Iris Morales, that's where the rebel imagination was born. As I grew, I learned that the way they were teaching you English is to be afraid of it. As if democracy only existed in the English language. And anything less will be not getting into that melting pot. So I learned at 10 years old either to master English or be afraid of it and join the statistics of dropping out later on. That's where a mirror in my own backstage was also born. So I like to, now, you know, like many of us, Your transformation is not only the language, but you got to change your hairstyle, you got to change your speech, you got to change your rhythms, the way you walk. And you forget about rice and beans philosophy. You forget about your rice and beans. You know? My mother taught us three important words in our first month in school. She says, the first word you gotta learn is hamburger. And we say, and we were going, hamburger, hamburger. Ma, ¿qué quieres decir hamburger? Cállate, hamburger, just say hamburger. Why? Because you don't know what the food is, you don't know how to spell it, you know. So, hamburger. Then it was French fries. Hamburger, French fries, hamburger, French fries. And then me being stupid, I said, okay, what's the third word? Again, she smacks me again. She says, hamburger, French fries, ketchup. And there we were. So we knew that it was gonna be a language of will, a language of self-identity, and being a poet was the best option. This is called cowboynomics because we went to cowboys and Indians. Roy Rogers and Gene Autry were my heroes at the time before I discovered Zorro. You know, and I love Zorro because he was the first dude that had a mustache. And I said, oh, Zorro. So I jumped from Roy Rogers to Zorro. And then, of course, nobody could beat Bruce Lee. You know, because that was our hero at the time also. And he had the same fight. You know, Chinese are not dogs. And he fought that, and it was everybody saying, wow, look at this guy. You know, fighting martial arts to protect his national identity and his pride. This is called cowboynomics, and it goes like this. Go home, America. But you may never know exactly where, and home is now a foreign affair. An alliance with hideous tyrants and oligarchic dictators holding peace ransomed by treachery, with purple hearts that seduce the filthy rich marching with the saints to resurrect the profiteers by brutally impoverishing the noble poor who worship bold-faced liberation. As these pot-belly autocrats ambush the assassinated dead by ripping off the tongues of prayers of widowed mothers and stolen wives who sleepwalk to sniff or kiss those demise that embrace to heal their own wounds. When there could be no question, the doves that pray by day turn into bats at night to play with vultures in early morning and rape virginity before it is born so they could all withstand the wild stench of freedom. Come home, America. Ship winds or hit the road and get off the next exit, but perhaps you may not be that aware. Home is now a foreign affair, a flea market where mice and rat patrols turn amok like scattered shadows under a drunken moon. To plead bargain with the flies and insects for chopped off genitals or mutilated breasts and the rampaged eyes torn out of children's faces when diehard cynics trade aspirations with right-wing maggots so they could all scrounge the heartland and dance passionately the tangled delta with ravaged nuns before sucking deaths from its anus. Return home, America. Remain to patrol your own heart, but you may never know exactly where when home is now a foreign affair, and outward bound backyard broker, set adrift from dusk to dawn, between plantain trees and bamboo skies, past all these roadblocks and side roads of genocide to mount its flag on uprooted winds with rattlesnake eyes to bewitch the drumbeat of war dogs who get unscrupulously drunk on amnesia before asking with prick diplomacy for the neurotic fascist daughter's hand so they could all bankroll the pomp and pride of the elite in the name of national security. Stay home, America. Come and shift winds, or hit the road and get off the next exit. Return to yourself and remain to patrol your own heart, but you may never know exactly where, nor perhaps be that aware. Home is now a foreign affair, where American is no longer spoken anymore. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I guess it's my turn. When I was presented with the theme, Comparative Militarizations and Narratives of Healing, I was unsure how I would fit into the conversation. So I had conversation and understood then a broader definition of militarization. But as I thought about it after our conversation, I said, well, actually, my starting point is militarization in the most traditional sense. Thus, the flag to represent who I am. It's the Puerto Rican flag in mourning. You may know that Puerto Rico was colonized, was taken as a colonial possession as a result of the Spanish-American War in 1898, and an actual military government was established for 2 years, and thereafter the United States has controlled Puerto Rico till the present, where a junta has been designated to decide the austerity measures that they will take in order to pay off the debt or to pay off the interest to the bondholders and to keep the corrupt politicians in Puerto Rico in place. And so young people have been fighting the junta and this recent development of colonialism and militarization. And they took the bright red and blue out of the flag and made it just white and black to indicate that we're a nation in mourning. And so in the spirit of the young people of Puerto Rico, the young people in this country, Puerto Ricans, we had the greatest migration of Puerto Ricans until recent history in the 1940s. And out of that migration, the children of that migration, some of you may know the history, some not, so I'm just gonna go through it. The children of that migration joined the 60s movements. Now, how many of you, I'm assuming the older folks in the room know, but of the younger folks, how many of you are familiar with the social movements of the 60s? Raise your hand a little bit. Okay, how many of you know about the Black Panther Party? All right, everybody knows the Black Panther Party, and you know that they're celebrating their 50th year this year, and actually the Schomburg is doing a year-long exhibition and on the Black Panther Party, photographs, panelists, and speakers, and Palante Siempre Palante, the Young Lords, the film that I produce will be screened on Thursday as part of these events. And how do I connect the two? And I said that we were, my generation was part of the 60s movements in the United States because I like this phrase about crisscrossing lives, because the Black Panther Party influenced all of the communities in the United States, the Puerto Ricans, the Chicanos, the Asians, the Native American, and internationally. I can mention to you some of the Asian organizations that we worked with here in the city in Philadelphia that wherever I go and I raise it, nobody knows. If they know the young lords, they don't know the young lords, they know even less the Asian organizations. In New York City, we worked very closely with Iwakun, and in Philadelphia, I also worked very closely with an organization called Yellow Seeds. There were other larger organizations on the West Coast. Many, many, many organizations developed Puerto Rico. Every community had organizations, and we were all inspired by the Black Panther Party. We worked in collaboration. I had intended to read something that I thought was very pertinent to today's Black Lives Matter movements, but after hearing the presentations before me, I think I want to read something about the women in the Young Lords. All history, people's histories, our people's histories have not been told. And when they get told by somebody else, you always find that they fall short. And so there are a number of things that are coming out in the 60s, and I encourage you to see the, go to the Schomburg and really see the documentation of the Black Panther Party. And with the Young Lords, there were several exhibits. And the reason that it's important is because, you know, our struggles continue. Black Lives is not new. Any of the movements that are taking place today, the immigration movement, the, you know, student movement, every movement is not new. It's a continuation, and we continue our struggle from generation to generation. And so, as I meet with young people across the country, I realize that there's a break in the history, and there's a break sometimes in young people knowing what our history is. And I also see on the other side, sometimes people my age, the older generation, criticizing, oh, they don't know this and they don't know that. And I think that it's our responsibility to make sure that that history gets passed on the best we can, because we're not in control of the media that's going to make it massive, although today there's more possibility for that than there was in the past. But one of the areas that has not been talked about and that generally gets addressed in second maybe or never, or one-dimensional terms, is the role of women in these movements. And so I took it upon myself to write this history before I go off the planet, and as our memories are rapidly fading. And as I started to write this, I realized that people wanted me to write a story about reproductive justice or reproductive rights. And I found it very difficult to write a woman's story, because the woman's story is the people's story. We were not a separatist organization, so I couldn't write a separatist story. We were integrated into all of the issues that faced our community, so that's the story I had to write. But I did take a specific look at what we call the revolution within the revolution, because there's obviously patriarchy. We all get raised in a patriarchal society, and so we're influenced by that and by the structures of society, and we internalize those ideas as well. So our battles are usually external and internal. But I think I'm going to read just that short part on women to give you a sense of who we were. Women joined the New York chapter of the Young Lords in 1969 as the organization was being formed. We enlisted to fight poverty and racism, to end discrimination, to free Puerto Rico, and to improve our lives and those of our families. Our struggle was for justice against powerful economic interests and institutions, and we believed that the equality of women was inseparable from society's progress as a whole. With an enthusiastic sense of possibilities, we embraced the revolution within the revolution. This phrase from a speech delivered by Fidel Castro in 1966 had credited Cuban women with furthering the revolutionary process of that nation. The women in the Young Lords pursued a similar idea, a story within a story that is barely known. The women in the Young Lords were rebels, passionate about social justice and young. Most of us were between 16 and 26 years old. At our high point, approximately one third of the Young Lords were women. We were primarily Puerto Ricans, also African Americans, Cubans, and Dominicans, several from other Latin American backgrounds, or mixed Puerto Rican and South Asian or Filipino descent. The majority of us had been born or raised in the United States in Spanish-speaking homes, but English was our primary daily language. Arriving to the organization from different sectors of the community, we were wives, homemakers, and mothers with young children. Several of us had jobs in retail, stores, offices, or hospitals, generally in clerical and administrative positions. Others were unemployed or were high school or college students. Several were lesbians. Some were survivors of domestic violence and drug addiction. We were also activists and community organizers. The women in the Young Lords understood that to fight for social change, our organization had to mobilize the community and develop relationships with the people, with the politically, economically, and educationally disenfranchised. This meant living our politics and working in coalition with other activists. It meant creating alliances with workers and students and building new networks with artists and progressive policy makers. It also meant battling with city officials, self-serving politicians, and the New York City police. The realities for Puerto Rican and other women of color at the time were extremely bleak, with few prospects for a better future. Racist and sexist barriers dominated all facets of society. Educational opportunities were especially limited. The majority of working women of color were steered into low-paying, unskilled, and semi-skilled jobs with few chances to advance. High numbers of Puerto Rican and African American single mothers with children survived on public assistance with no other options. Inevitably, the early survival programs of the Young Lords responded to the needs of women. For example, the first Young Lords clothing drive in East Harlem in 1969 reached out to 150 welfare mothers and distributed coats, sweaters, shoes, and other basic items to them. A successive free clothing programs aided similar families in need. The free breakfast program fed the school-age children of single and working mothers. Door-to-door health testing in poor neighborhoods brought medical attention to children at risk for lead poisoning. Convinced of the power of direct action, the women in the Young Lords became fighters, leaders, and political thinkers. We embraced three main principles in our organizing work: a belief in the right of poor people to economic, social, and political power, an emphasis on racial equality, self-determination, and human rights, and a feminist viewpoint that demanded a woman's right to control her reproduction and to share equally in all aspects of society. By imagining what society could be, we were energized to action. Throughout New York City poorest neighborhoods, young women in blue jeans, proudly wearing the purple beret of the young lords, were easily identifiable. We were out every day in Puerto Rican communities, speaking with people who rarely receive serious attention from anyone, listening to their opinions and engaging them in discussions. Even in freezing cold weather, we sold Palante, the young lord's newspaper, on street corners, in subways, bodegas, shopping centers, clinics, and beauty salons, wherever people gathered. During the summer months, we sold the paper at city beaches and parks, during festivals and parades. In the mornings, we cooked breakfast for children, and in the evenings, taught political education classes in community centers, housing projects, and other neighborhood venues. We helped fellow members who could not read or write to develop these skills, and stayed up late into the night with recruits who wanted to kick the heroin habit, helping them to become drug-free. Women also participated in takeovers, organized protests, and got arrested. In many ways, women were the backbone of the Young Lords.
Beautiful.
So I would like to approach the subject maybe from a personal point of view, because it has to do with how we see ourselves, how we see other people. Mm. And I see in the media especially how we are, our minds are programmed to see, you know, through sound bites and visions, visuals, like the focus on specific things, and they keep, you know, it's always the black people that are being shot at, it's always this, it's always that, so that it's like they're programming us in a Pavlovian way, you know, here's the image, now you react, here's the image, now you react, so that eventually we get to the point where we see people that are presented on TV and we start having that reaction. We're not even conscious of it. And I have found that even myself in my reaction, because I came from a revolutionary family. My father fought in the Spanish Civil War. My mother was a card-carrying communist, and she worked with LaGuardia, and she was the black sheep of her family. And my father came from a Finnish immigrant family, and my mother came from a very wealthy Chicago family. So I had a lot of diversity in my exposure in life. But I was taught to really think about what's being presented. And of course, Edward R. Murrow was, I mean, he was like God. When Edward R. Murrow came on, we had to be quiet, we had to sit in front and listen to him. And he's probably turning in his grave by how the media presents the news these days. What I've discovered in my own experiences, and I'll give you an example. I was at an international conference, this was decades ago, and it was a lot of diplomats. And what diplomats do, because they have to be so careful about what they say and to whom, and they have to put on a certain face, etc., to break, give themselves some freedom, they get together amongst themselves and they play a game called truth. Now, I don't know if they still do this, but that's what they were doing then. And you sit around the table and you can ask anybody at the table a question, and they either have to tell the truth or they get up and they leave. And so we were going around, and I noticed that this black man, American, was there, and he kept asking questions about race. So I wanted to ask him a question. I said, when you get up in the morning and you look in the mirror, what do you see? He said, I see black. I said, you don't see human, you don't see man. No, I see black. And I felt that in my heart, that he couldn't, that was reflected to him so much in his life that he couldn't perceive himself as a human being. And I, after the game, I tried to have a conversation with him, but I could see that he had this barrier that prevented us from communicating as human beings. And I think this happens to all of us in different ways, in the ways we look at people. I will share one experience. My brother and I, back in 1961, so this was just when the civil rights stuff was starting, we took a Greyhound trip from New York through the South to Arizona. We had no idea what we were getting into. As soon as we went south of Washington, D.C., and of course we weren't raised this way, it was coloreds only, whites only, everything. Bathrooms, water fountains, and you go to the bus stop, it's coloreds only, whites only, diners. My brother, who had dark eyes and dark hair, you put him out in the sun, he had got a really dark tan, and he had a dark tan then. And I was pale. And so we went, we weren't sure which restaurant we were supposed to go into. So first we went into the white one. They said, oh no, he can't come here. So then I said, okay, fine. So I went with him into the, oh no, you can't come in here. So the only way we could eat together was he went into the black one and got something to take out. I went into the white one and got something to take out. And we sat on the bus together, and that's what we had to do all the way through the South. But what really sticks with me even now is the intense fear and hatred in these people's eyes. That you can't, I mean, somewhere in there is a soul, but there was no way I could see it. It terrified me. It really did. So I briefly understood what people of color have to experience all the time. This terrible fear where you can't even connect. I mean, you can't, it's like there's nothing there in the eyes. Now, when I was, I've been really working on connecting with people as human beings. And even on the subway with strangers, if somebody's eyes meet me, I meet them. I don't close off, which is the typical New Yorker thing. Oh, I don't see you. Or, you know, I'm looking at the ads, etc. So I've had a couple of really wonderful experiences where it's clear that we really are all connected if we allow ourselves to have that experience. One time, I was sitting on a bus, and there was a small Muslim girl sitting with her father, and he had two girly sunglasses on his shirt, and she was sitting next to him, and I was sitting there with my sunglasses. And she smiled at me, and I smiled back. And we just started communicating, no words. And then she pointed like to this, and then pointed to her father. And so I saw the two sunglasses, and I said, like two, like you've got two, I've only got one. And she laughed, and she said, no, and she pointed to her mother behind with her other sister. And then she went like this, and I understood she wanted me to take my sunglasses off. Through the whole bus ride, we were communicating without words, laughing. I couldn't tell you the subject, but I know we were connecting on a heart level. Another experience I had was, actually I was coming from meeting with Chong, and I got on the subway at 68th, and there was a black woman sitting there, and I don't know what happened, but I suddenly knew her life. She didn't see me, but I felt like we were communicating. I knew this woman has been working. She's a grandmother. She's going home to take care of the grandkids. I don't know how this happened, but I'm telling you that we really are all connected. And somehow we have to get past this. I think what the media does is the judgment thing. I mean, they present ideals. This is the ideal of what you're supposed to be, or, you know, you're ranked hierarchically according to where you fit on the ideal thing. And what it does is it takes us away from our own integrity, the integrity of our heart. And that, to me, is our hope. That is where democracy is. That is where our evolution is. It's in the heart. It's not in the fear that's in the mind. When I was in India, I was in India teaching English to Tibetan refugees, and the Dalai Lama was having a conference of Western psychiatrists. And he said, what do you think is the most difficult, what is the most common problem? And they said, self-hatred. And he was actually hurt. Somebody said he cried. I don't know if that's true. But he said, I can't even imagine what that's like. But if you think about all the ways that the powers that be, the government, the media, whatever, programs us almost to not value ourselves, but to go for certain ideals, or we have to judge ourselves this way or that, which leads us away from our own integrity. So how can you love yourself if you're trying to be something that you're not? I know with myself, I was always hiding myself, especially as a woman. And I totally understand that. It's not, I mean, we're not done. We still got a long way to go. But back then, you were silenced if you were a woman. You were treated like you could not possibly have anything of value to offer to a conversation. It's just like you're there because if you happen to be what they call beautiful, then that's okay. You can kind of stand on the side and just be beautiful for us, but you have no value. And the 70s was quite a battle for us. It really was. And the intense hostility when we started speaking our voice. Still going on. It's still going on. I think healing is something that each of us has a responsibility to do, which is to be aware of our own inner wisdom, which is there. Everybody has it. It's just a matter of becoming aware of that. And when you get to that inner wisdom, then you can start relating to other people as equals, as human beings, as spirits that bring light to the world. And part of that awareness is just being aware how you breathe. How you breathe. How you breathing at any moment tells you the state of your mind. And you can also change the state of your mind by changing the rhythm of your breath and being aware of how you move, how you relate to your environment. All these things are ways of taking your power back and being true to who you really are. I'll read a short section from my book. This is the first chapter. It's a celebration of the grandmother's 75th birthday. All afternoon and into the evening we were talking, toasting, and clinking glasses. Grandma's eyes sparkled under her thinning white hair and she kept smiling as she looked from Dad to Oni and back again. Their deep voices resonated in harmony with each other and their laughter peeled off easily at the slightest excuse. Whenever Grandma said something to them and finished, they'd both chuckle. I knew from her expression that she was teasing them. Mother remained silent through most of the afternoon, sat gracefully posed as though for a portrait. A few times she shot Dad a discreet look of disapproval about his rowdiness. I sat quietly while I basked in the warmth and spirit of the celebration and listened intently to Oni's tales of all the places he'd been to since his last visit. "Have you been to China lately?" Mother asked after a brief pause in the revelry. "Ah, Maggie, indeed I have. We were just there on our last crossing. Please tell me what you saw," she implored. "What is happening in China?" The need in her voice startled me, but it was the way she said China that stuck in my mind. I felt that the place called China on the other side of the world had a greater hold on her than Beth and I did. "Ah, Maggie, it doesn't look good. We docked in Shanghai and thought we'd take a longshore leave. Instead, we refueled, loaded up, and got ourselves out of there. It was too dangerous. The Wangpu was crowded with gunboats. Even the sampans and junks were armed. I went ashore only for a few hours. I wanted to find your gate. There were gunshots in the streets. People were wheeling and dealing as usual, but everything was in chaos. The money was practically worthless, and the exchange rate kept changing. I tried to buy you a shibao, Maggie, but it was impossible. The vendors kept changing their prices mid-sentence. Oh, Uncle Oni, please tell me more about Shanghai. Ah, so you do have a voice, Carlotta. Well, I will tell you what Shanghai once was, but I think by the time you're old enough to go there, it will be a very different place. Beth and Carlotta will not go to Shanghai, Mother said. Ah, Maggie, who knows where your sweet birdlings will go when they take flight. Shanghai, I said with a big smile on my face. Tell us about the old Shanghai. Shanghai belonged to the world even more than New York does. She was truly an international city. You could hear every language imaginable spoken in the streets of Shanghai. It was a city of sharp contrast, bright colored silks and gray colored buildings, elegant wealth mixing with slave wage labor in the rickshaw filled streets. The great Yangtze River runs all the way from Tibet to Shanghai. It cuts across China like a waistband across Buddha's belly. And at the mouth of the Yangtze, at the convergence of three rivers, Shanghai sits like a jewel placed at the ocean's feet. Why, Oni, you're waxing poetic, but I would like to hear more about what you saw. Well, as I said, I gave up trying to buy you that dress. I went on to Yorge's place, but he was already gone. He had left the week before. Mei Ling was still there. Mother listened intently. She told me Yorge couldn't get her out. She said he tried everything. He didn't try hard enough, Mother whispered. I stayed with her a while, trying to comfort her. There was nothing I could do. Finally, I had to go. I can still see her standing there in the fog under that red lantern at her door. She was wearing a faded silk dress and had no money for buying clothes. I gave her what I could, but she just kept sobbing, Shwandula, Shwandula. Yorgi would have done everything possible to get her out, but she had a record and her papers were a mess. You can't trust anyone to fix anything now. They take your money and run. I knew I couldn't do anything, but I hated to leave her there. The communists will soon take over Shanghai. It's just a matter of time. I don't know what will happen to her then. It's not good, Maggie. It's not good. The Reds have taken over most of China. Chiang Kai-shek has been on the run for some time. I don't know why he lasted this long, but the end is inevitable. Mother sighed and went into one of her dreamlike states, looking out into a distance we could never see. I looked at Beth, but knew better than to ask the questions which exploded in my mind. Back to China, Red, Chiang Kai-shek, Old World, Xi Pao, Shwandula. I didn't understand what those words meant, but they shed a sliver of light on my mother's secret world. I held on to those words and stored them like precious jewels in my mind.
Beautiful. I'll now turn the conversation to a discussion. I think we heard four different types of episodes or ways in which militarization takes place. And one of the ways I wanted to think about was the styles of thought via Said's idea in Orientalism. Orientalism being a style of thought that becomes embedded and saturated over centuries and becomes codified and embedded on a cellular level in terms of the way we're fashioned. I'm also thinking about Lisa Lowe's Intimacies of Four Continents, where she talks about projects of remembering and forgetting. What do we remember? What do we forget? Henri Guru talks about the war on youth. Cornel West talks about the war on the poor. Iowa mentions something about mentally ill, immediate, and fear. I'm interested in the war on drugs and the way in which it places certain types of social controls on populations. But I'm also interested about the war on consciousness, how we imagine, how we experience potentiality. And I'm thinking about this in relationship, for example, with W.E. Du Bois, The Souls of Black Folk. He talks about the veil of America, and he talks about a certain gift of second sight. And what exactly is a certain gift of second sight? What does that encompass? One way that I'm thinking about it is I'm wearing a green bracelet here, and it's a green bracelet that I've been making for the last few months. The inspiration behind the green bracelet is when I was with my sister, my older sister, who's 2 years older than me. She was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, stomach cancer. She was my last remaining blood relative here in America. And I was in Atlanta, Georgia, listening to her overnight, just difficulties getting through the night. And in that terror, in that space of fear, in that space of almost utter helplessness, I looked up at the ceiling and there was a fire alarm with a neon green circle coming from its light. And at that moment, something happened. Something calmed, a reverberation started becoming more of a melody, and the feelings that I were having started just becoming more comfortable. They started to melt away, and I gained some sort of comfort by just looking at this light up in the sky. When I came back to New York City, I started riding the 6th train, and on the 6th train, lo and behold, here are these green circles, the only subway line that has green circle neons. And I was like, this is interesting, okay. And I had that same type of flashback to that moment in that space of the hospice room. And at that moment, I felt my body having a kind of gift of second sight, a kind of way of processing terror and pain and loneliness, to the where I started re-signifying the signifier, reattaching a signifier to that signifier that meant different. So every time that I come to Hunter College now and I ride the 6th train, I'm looking at the window and I'm seeing outside the window multiple green circles. And while everyone is playing this separation game, this alienation game on the subway, I'm in this kind of bubble comfort of just happiness and joy in terms of this type of processing. So what I'm trying to move the conversation towards is thinking about narratives of healing, ways in which we're thinking about structured forms of violence, whether it's ideological forms of forgetting, ways in which we're trained in schools in terms of our language and our bodies, what Iris talks about, within even in terms of when you're trying to make some sort of social change, how we do not allow ourselves to reproduce the very violences that we're critiquing, right? So in that sense, I think a certain gift of second sight emerges. So I want to open up discussion and think about how we might think about and talk about how we experience these types of phenomena.
Maybe a good seg is to close out with the feminist writing, just a blurb, and I'm going to allow Jose and Hal to close out with the poetic verse in a more lyrical way. You know, Gloria Azadua, the book that I'm referencing, said by creating a new mythos, those of you who don't know her work, she published Borderlands La Frontera and Border Theory, 1987. She's a prominent member of women of color feminisms in the 1980s that arose. By the time we get to 2000, the Modern Languages Association, the modern convention for all literature professors, from Romantics to early modern to 19th century British to 20th century American, had a centralized panel on her work. So, and I think it speaks to certain members about what types of alternative knowledges or epistemologies or historiographies or subjectivities might be included in the way in which we think about knowledge. What is knowledge? Azadua says, by creating a new mythos, that is a change in the way we perceive reality, the way we see ourselves, and the way we behave. La mestiza creates a new consciousness. The work of mestiza consciousness is to break down the subject-object duality that keeps her prisoner, and to show in the flesh and through the images in her work how duality is transcended. I think so much of the talk we have today is us and them. And I'm not sure if that's I understand its role, but I'm not sure if that's the narrative that I subscribe to now. The answer to the problem between the white race and the color, between males and females, lies in healing the split that originates in the very foundation of our lives, our culture, our languages, our thoughts. A massive uprooting of dualistic thinking in the individual and collective consciousness is the beginning of a long struggle, but one that could, in our best hopes, bring us to the end of rape, of violence, of war.
All right.
Iris, I need your advice. I have three poems that come to mind, and maybe you could decide, how's that? Never done that before. Ready? You don't know the poems, right? So the poetic fate comes to be. I have a poem called O Shakespeare, where I actually spoke with the man about what is the lesson or the role of the poet. So it's me and Shakespeare. The other one is called Hypocrisy Held Hostage, based on what's going on today with the elections and what may happen Tuesday. And the third is an existential poem called A Day in the Life of a Mannequin. So, raise your hands. Oh, Shakespeare? Hypocrisy held hostage? A Day in the Life of a Mannequin.
Because, come on, people voted twice.
You're probably undecided voters.
You're no undecided.
Edith, what would you say? Shakespeare, hypocrisy held hostage.
I think more people wanted hypocrisy.
Hypocrisy?
Yeah. Yeah.
Here we go. Okay, ready? Take care. Okay, this is hypocrisy held hostage. The elections. What mockery! These chronicles of the puppet masters who indulge in frolicking spectacles to campaign for applause and dim the contradictions with lip fornicating promises mixed with intellectual piss. While parading in fundraising dinners to impersonate the truth by dissipating the problems with an abundance of incumbent small talk to forecast dangerous nonsense with snookering faces immune to shock as this Cold War dies in the eyes of mad sheep. These puppet masters are gross national products, appearing before closed doors like shrieking nuggets of neurotic crabs and stockpiling scavengers who drift as if politics was another Broadway show, switching from donkeys to elephants into brooding messiahs and superstars by swarming from land, air, or sea to audition with grin or contempt and bite off the kneecaps without ever wrinkling your clothes. And in the mornings, they have breakfast with our asses as we twitch, itch, and scratch in silence while analyzing the kind of circus we live in, be it true or false or none of the above. Meantime, all else is normal. Computers hunger for more human habits. The poor still eat grunts stuck on dinner plates to balance their budgets. The winds entrapped in the illusions of clocks leave behind acid rain with strange ashes. While rocks still dream of walking outside of themselves, perhaps feigning death, but not fate. While yet, out of all reason, lost and found philosophers wander off like offsprings of Cassandra, musing why the history of misery remains illogical, as these puppet masters lust for necromancy to rehearse war on pinball machines and eclipse thy living by equalizing the dead and checkmate. But nor could we survive these ballistic games by moving out of the government and play frisbee, while these cockeyed scoundrels, jackals, sovereigns, and bears manage camouflage deceptions like Judas. Once these tacit charlatans delude each other, we're all pawns of this bidding war, aligned or not, native or alien, naive or obscurant. The bet is not on the outcome, nor if the dead yield higher dreams of voodoo shitballs or cheese-made eulogies, when even in great disguise, death reverses itself. Death has no immigrants. Only obese disciples who gravitate when the winds fall to bet on the impact of this pending storm. Until all that is left When the squirming germs in delirium declines is a shocking editorial written in noble blood with unsalted oil. And the rare distinctions between human tears and the howling of animals heat frozen in hellish horror when hypocrisy is held hostage. What mockery. But do not bitch or mourn. Think and become your own revolution. Thank you.